Good morning. I hope you've all survived the rain. In the words of Maya Angelou, the American philosopher and writer, all storms run out of rain. Just take that. That old 100th that you've just sung was the first hymn that my mother ever taught me, a long time ago. Here are the intimations. Firstly, a well-kent face, Tom McLeod, will lead us today. And welcome back, Tom. It's good to see you, and we look forward to hearing you. The rest of the intimations, the teas and coffees, once again, are available after the service, and volunteers are required to help with the teas and the coffees on a Sunday. So if you feel free to help, please let somebody know. Linda, I think, or any of the girls that are there at the teas and coffees. The coffee shop is on Tuesdays. I'm not going to go through everything here because you should all have a copy in your hands. If you don't, there are some on the table outside. I do want to highlight that the following items that are needed for the food bank. The list is there, but it's slightly changed. Emphasis has changed to some of the things there on that list. And we look forward to celebrating the 140th anniversary of the Boys' Brigade in a couple of weeks' time. Yes, pastoral cover over the period the 3rd to the 17th will be provided by Brian Henry. I think his telephone number was in last week's intimations. If you don't know it, then Alfred in the office will certainly be able to help you if you need pastoral care of any time, of any kind, I should say. And the Beetle Drive raised a total of £130, which is an excellent figure. I have one further intimation. Joyce Wilcox let the church know that her mother, Iris Edgar, those who know Iris, I don't know her, but is in Station 12 in Ayr Hospital. And she's been a member of Castle Hill for many years. And if anybody would like to visit her, it is at Station 12 in Ayr Hospital. And I think that's all the intimations. If anybody has anything else, no hands are raised. Tom, they're all yours.
Thank you. I love it when a plan comes together. What was it, Morgan? What was it, Morgan and Wise said? Oh, we've got all the right words, but no necessarily in the right order. And you know what? Every time I come here, I just love the fact, because in my church, we don't have an organist. So we have to play, and the men for the men's breakfast will know this one. We have to play the music through the computer. And see, when you play that one, let us build a house where God. So it's wonderful to hear it being played at its right speed and being able to sing it at its right speed. Right, well, I've got some youngsters with us this morning. And I always keep my children's address in, even if there are no youngsters, because I feel I'm cheating you if I don't. So we've got a children's address this morning. You might need a wee bit of help, right? Because as you can see, I've got grey hair. I'll not tell you that I'm 66 nearly, right? So I'm an old fuddy-duddy, okay? And this morning, we're going to look at sweeties, right? But we're going to look at sweeties. Oh, probably, I would probably have about your age, right? That shows you how long ago that was, right? But there's nothing wrong with the memory. My memory works fine. So you might need some help from the older children in the congregation. I'm going to show some pictures, and I want to see if they can guess what the sweetie is. Because, you know, when I was younger, I hadn't met my wife when I was your age, but when I was younger, my wife's uncle used to own Dalglish's Sweetie Shop in Cumnock, which used to be right across the road for the shopping centre that's no longer there because they knocked it down a couple of years ago. But it was right in the corner of Glasnock Street. And you used to go in there, and there'd be these big jars of sweeties. And they were beautiful to see. So we're going to start with our first sweetie and see if anybody can guess what that is. Somebody shouting out to you? Cola cubes, well done. Hey, AV corner, am I allowed to move or have I got to stand still as usual? Because I like to move a bit, right? Oh, I can move because the slides are not, I'm not in the slides, that's all right. Right. Oh, close. Close. Not rhubarb and custard, no. But I'll tell you something, these growing trees, and they come in the same colours, red and green. Sometimes you get yellow. Somebody's got it, apples. They are sewer apples, as they were called. Right? You probably can't read that, but it does say sewer apples in the front of the jar. Right, next one. Oh, these were one of my favourites. You probably remember these as the yellow ones. They're sherbets. What kind of sherbet? Strawberry. Strawberry sherbets. Carry on. Right. Oh, that's an easy one. Jelly babies. They're my favourite. Well, they're nearly my favourite. They're one of my favourites. Right, next one. Oh, pineapple cubes, eh? Hey, you guys all know your sweeties. Hands up those that are all pre-diabetic. Aye, that's why, because we ate these sweeties. Right, next. Oh, that's a wee bit harder than this. This is one of my favourite flutes. It's red coloured. No, not cherries. It's close. That's a close guess, though. In fact, that's a very good guess. They're just a wee bit bigger than cherries, but the same size, maybe a wee bit smaller than an apple, between an apple and a cherry. Somebody said it. Plums. Sour plums, as they were called. Right, sour plums. Right. Now, are you ready? Right, you ready for this one? Right. Go on. Rhubarb and custard, I kept my teeth on this side, I never heard them. Rhubarb and custard, well done. Right. Oh, my favourite character at Christmas. Bah. Go on. Humbug. Bah, humbug. Right, next one. Jelly babies. No, jelly babies. Jelly beans. You ever been to a church fair or some other fair where there's one of these and you pay 20 pence to guess how many's in the jar? Well, we're needing new instruments and new equipment for the kitchen. So I thought I would do it this morning. No, I'm only kidding you. The day you get to have a free guess, right? And if somebody gets it spot on, they get my jar of jelly beans, right? Now, you've got to be spot on. You're not going to be close. You've got to be spot on. I'm making that very clear, right? Know that I'm very protective of my jelly beans, but... Right, just shout out numbers, and if I hear somebody shouting the right number, I'll stop you. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. 170, higher. 253, higher.
278.
What school did you go to, Margaret? 253 higher, 178. Or 278. Right? No. We're still higher than 278. 320 is too high. Last 10 seconds.
310.
280. Just a bit too low. No. Too high. Too high. Five, four, three, two, one. Time up. Now, what we do normally in this situation, just to show there's no cheating, right? Now, who was in the office with me this morning? Francis. Francis, you were in the office. I was counting these jelly beans, wasn't I? So I wasn't cheating. The fact I ate half a dozen, that was nothing to do with it. Right? So I counted these jelly beans before I came in this morning. And the exact number is, I'll give you one later, lads, it's honest. Because I'm going to have a big jar when I'm finished. The exact answer is 292. See? Nobody said that number. You know, to be honest, I would have been absolutely amazed if you had actually got the number dead on, right? Most times when we do that kind of thing at a Christmas fair or a church fair, we do it to the person who gets the nearest number. Because very rarely do you get somebody who guesses the exact number. Now, we're going to hear a reading from the Bible later on this morning that tells us that God knows exactly the number of hairs in everybody's head. Now, for those of you looking on top of me, you'll notice it's getting a wee bit thinner. The white hairs beginning to fall out. So as I look round about, I can see there's a few people who've got a lot more hair than I've got. One or two have got about the same amount, and we'll not go any further than that, okay? And you know, I think that's amazing that God knows us so well that he can tell you exactly how many hairs are in your head. And do you know why that is? That's because God created each and every one of us in his image, and he knows everything there is to know about us. He knows us so well because he loves us. He created us in love, and he loves us. And you know, that's an amazing love that someone knows you that well. I love my wife, but I would never, ever be able to tell you how many hairs are in her head. I could tell you lots of other things about her, but I wouldn't tell you, not in church anyway, right? But I wouldn't know that. Isn't that amazing that God loves us so much that he knows every single hair in our head and he knows us so well? Let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Father, we gather as your children, known, accepted, and valued. We gather as your family, a family that cares for one another, a family that seeks to grow together in love and understanding, and a family that journeys through the good and the bad together. Lord, as father of our family, you provide everything we need and more. We thank you for your generosity to us. We thank you for the shelter of our homes, for the food that we receive, for the warmth of the love of our families, and most of all, Lord, we thank you for the gift of your Son, through whom you reveal your power of your love, a love that Jesus showed us has the enormous potential for good when we share it with others. Father, we are sorry that there are times when our family becomes a clique, when we refuse to share your bountiful gifts, when we fail to share your love with others, and we try to keep it to ourselves, when we close our doors on those who want to be part of our family, when we ignore the needs of our neighbors, our community, and our world. Father, forgive us. Help us to grow in love. Challenge us to grow in faith and inspire us to grow with hope. Father, you call us to be a community of faith that can transform the world. You call us to proclaim you, to proclaim your love and your story. Help us, Lord, to do it confidently. And may we be confident without stifling or snuffling out the confidence of others. Instead, Father, bless us and enable us by the power of your Spirit to be a blessing to others. And may your Spirit lead our searching, guide our listening, and keep our feet firmly in the footsteps of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray together to say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, I know how you all love your exercise first thing in the morning. So this morning, we're going to have a bit of exercise during our second hymn. Our children's hymn is, I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. Right, so there's some actions to this. I'll just stay here. I was going to get in the front there and then I realized I'd have to move the camera. Right, it's, I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together, all around the world. I've forgotten the next bit of the line, but it's something about Jesus. All who follow Jesus all around the world. Yes, we are the church together. And that last bit, you hold hands with the person next to you, all right? So husbands, that means you have to hold the wife's hands, okay? Maybe the first time in about 20 years, but you've got to hold her hand. Okay, thanks, Liz. day I really would love to is buying.
The reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 10, reading from verses 24 to verses 39. No pupil is greater than his teacher. No slave is greater than his master. So, a pupil should be satisfied to be like his teacher, and a slave should be like his master. If the head of the family is called Beelzebub, the members of the family will be called even worse names. So do not be afraid of people. Whatever is now covered up will be uncovered, and every secret will be made known. What I am telling you in the dark, you must repeat in broad daylight. And what you have heard in private, you must announce from the housetops. Do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of God, who can kill both the body and the soul in hell. For only a penny, you can buy two sparrows. Yet, not one sparrow falls to the ground without your Father's consent. As for you, even the hairs of your head have been counted. So, do not be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. If anyone declares publicly that he belongs to me, I will do the same before my Father in heaven. But if anyone rejects me publicly, I will reject him before my Father in heaven. And may God add his blessing to this reading from his holy word. Amen.
Thank you.
sermons. I'm not sure if that's because they've liked it or they haven't liked the sermon. But by way of explanation, I always try to explain it by saying, the first thing I do is I go to the lectionary, I open the lectionary, and it tells me what the reading for that week is. So this week, I looked up the lectionary, and I didn't like the reading. So I picked another reading. And then what I normally do is I read that over three or four times at the beginning of the week, and let it sink in. So the parable of the talents I've read three or four times at the beginning of the week, and slowly it sinks in. Because of those of you who know me well, it takes me a wee while to get the little things and to remember things. Then of course you've got all the commentaries in the books that you can refer to that tell you what that passage is all supposed to be about, and then you can work out what you're going to say on a Sunday. Well, that's the theory. Sometimes it's easier than others, and sometimes it's harder. And every now and again, like most authors, you get what they call writer's block, and you can't think of a thing that you're going to say about that particular passage. Well, I'm just back from a holiday in Sorrento on Friday night, so I knew I wouldn't have time to do my sermon this week. So I sent it to the office the week before, the day before I went away on holiday. So that week happened to have been a very busy week at work, and a very frustrating week at work. And I had a lot on my mind, and I was struggling with this particular passage. So I decided, you know what? Time for some time out. Now what that means in my house is I go to the study, and I shut the study door. And Linda knows if the door's shut, no to come in, because I want some peace and quiet to try and think about what I'm going to do. There's no phone in that room. I don't take my mobile phone in, so I don't have to answer text messages or emails that come through on the phone. I can just sit there and prepare. Well, I was sitting there preparing, and all that was going through my head was, what time's that flight again? When am I getting picked up? And I just couldn't get anything at all. So in that case, I decided to revert to plan B. Plan B was to go and make a cup of coffee and sit down and watch the telly and hope and pray that some inspiration would come. So I tried plan B. Plan B didn't work. Went back to the study, and I was sitting there, and as you always do, I sort of looked up and I went, God help me, please. And just at that, there's a small carved statue that sits on the top of my computer table that I got when I was ordained into the ministry. It's a pair of praying hands. And I went, thank you, God, you're right. I forgot again, didn't I? I forgot the most fundamental thing of all, is that when you need help, all you need to do is pray. So that's what I did. I prayed. And God doesn't always answer the prayers straight away. Doesn't always answer them the way I hope he would answer them, but he does answer them. So I sat there for about another 20 minutes, finished my coffee. That didn't work. So I went to plan C, which was to go back and watch the telly again. And I switched on the television. Now, for those of you that have got Sky TV, I don't know if you know this, but there's 992 channels on Sky TV. And do you know what? I couldn't find anything to watch. I was struggling. But I do like the documentary channels. So I thought, I'll just go to the documentary channel and see what's on it. So I did. And it was a documentary about UNICEF. UNICEF was the United Nations International Children's Emergency Fund. That's what it was set up as, and it's now called the United Nations Children's Fund. It's an agency that is responsible for providing humanitarian and developmental aid to children throughout the world. It's fascinating. There's 192 countries where they have an office and territories. was the Convention of the Rights of Children. It was made around 34 years ago and is still used today. And it sets out the right of every child to a proper childhood, to be educated, to be healthy, to be treated fairly, and most of all, to be held. And then there was a phrase that they used, that the welfare of each and every child is protected. And when I heard that phrase, that was when God answered my prayers. The fact that every single child matters is a wonderfully appropriate Christian principle, because in the kingdom of God, each and every one of us is a child of God, and each and every one of us is protected by God, no matter our age, our gender, or our race. We are protected by God. He knows each and every one of us and knows our value. One of the clearest messages in the verses of today's gospel reading is the one that affirms us as children of God. God values each one of us, and there is no quality or unique personality trait that isn't recognized by God. He knows every part of us, and as I said to the children earlier, including every hair on our heads. This instinct of God to know us, cherish us, and rejoice in us can never be overstated. Amid so many other noises there is in our world today that tell us that we are of lesser value than others, this resounding affirmation of God for each of us is heard loud and clear in the passage we read this morning. All too often today, in the media and in social media, images of people, and particularly body images of people, are shared as the ideal, and we are told that that's what we must aspire to. We must be like them. And if we don't, we're regarded as something lesser. And unfortunately, as more and more people are bombarded by these images, there is consequences to that. And as we've heard, and unfortunately for some of us, experienced, this can lead to catastrophic consequences for those who believe these fake messages, that they are lesser because they don't live up to these images. In Scotland, we've always been very good at playing ourselves down, especially when it comes to our chances of winning any kind of sport. And there wasn't any rugby played last night, okay, before anybody asks. But I will turn to that other sport, the one with the wrong shape of all. If you look at the Scotland football team just now, it's doing wonderfully well. They've won the last four games, looks like they might qualify for the next big championship. However, I was listening to a particular, I think they call them podcasts, it's on the radio thing. And they were talking about, yeah, but only Scotland could throw that chance away. Do you remember Ali's Tartan Army when we were going to win the World Cup in 1978? We're masters at underselling ourselves, and in particular, our achievements. Individually, of course, that sometimes is a good trait, to keep countenance and not to be seen as pushy or arrogant, as can sometimes happen when we continually talk ourselves up. However, sometimes we do not think highly enough of ourselves and give credence to the wonderful work that people do and people are capable of. In today's passage in Matthew's Gospel, Jesus encourages us to shout from the rooftops, to share with the world The secret God passes on to us as his messengers. We as a church tend not to follow that example. We as a church tend to keep all that we do far too quiet at times. We tend to try and play it down. We as a church do lots of wonderful things. We work with food banks and charities. We run our own old folks' homes. We run our care system. And over the past years, we've seen churches in action in a number of areas, including here in Castle Hill, providing places of warmth for people who couldn't afford to heat their homes, providing hot meals for families that were struggling to meet the needs of their family and struggling to put food on their table. And even in extreme cases, the church will provide financial assistance for those who are in financial difficulties. And rightly, we do all of that without any regard for thanks or praise in doing it. But sometimes we need to let people know that that is part of the church work that we do. Most of the time, however, that work goes unseen to everyone except those who it's helped. We do not shout from the rooftops about all the good work we do. However, all this good work demonstrates God's love in action, and we need to become better at demonstrating God's love, at promoting and proclaiming God's love, for no other reason than to show others that they can be rescued from the sea of despair and to give them a glimpse of hope that there are people out there willing to help them in their hour of need. As I said earlier, to all, we are all God's children, and helping people in the smallest of ways shows them that they are loved and valued, and that we can make a world of difference to other people. And then finally, in our gospel reading today, Jesus offers us words of encouragement and reassurance that folk will get through these hard times and better times will come. He's also reminding us that we are all valuable and important to God, and therefore, no matter what we are going through at present, if we continue to follow Jesus, we will come to the end. So today, let us pledge to continue to let our actions shout from the rooftops about how much God loves, cares for each and every one of us, no matter our age, our race, or our gender. We are all God's children, and he loves us all equally. Amen. Let's continue our worship by singing together in 251, I, the Lord of sky and sea, or maybe even sea and sky.
Thank you. this sanctuary, let's come together and have prayers for others. Let us pray. Living God, source of all life, flowing with love in Christ, you give us living water. By your Spirit, we are washed, refreshed, challenged, and renewed. In prayer, we reach out to a world thirsting for justice, peace, and kindness. Lord, we pray for those countries where war has raged for far too long. In particular, Lord, we pray for Iraq, Pakistan, Ukraine, Russia, Syria, Afghanistan, the Sudan, and all other countries where conflict and injustice are rife. But today, Father, we pray especially for the people of Israel and Palestine after the escalation of the troubles in that region yesterday. Lord, we pray that all those in power will realize that retaliation and escalation will simply lead to more innocent people dying. And we pray that world leaders will work to bring everyone to the table and start a long process of reconciliation and peace. Lord, in your mercy, grant them peace. Almighty God, we pray for those who face oppression and discrimination, persecuted for what they believe in, or simply for who they are. We pray for all those who are victims of crime, of discrimination, and of bigotry. We pray for those who are persecuted on the basis of their color, their gender, or their religious beliefs. Lord, in your mercy, grant them justice. Lord, we pray for all those who work to build a more just and loving world, all who strive to bring help and healing to those in need, especially those working for organizations like UNICEF, Christian Aid, Oxfam, WaterAid, Médecins Sans Frontières, and Save the Children. Lord, in your mercy, grant them your strength and courage as they serve others. Caring God, we pray for the unemployed and homeless, the addicted, the lonely, those who feel unloved, the disabled and the disadvantaged. Father, we pray for those who are sick or suffering, those uncertain of their future, those who are dying, and their families seeking to stand with them at this time of need and uncertainty. And we pray too for those who are bereaved, whether recently or a long time ago. And now, Lord, in this moment of silence, we pray for those nearest and dearest to us who need your help in their lives. Lord, enfold them in your care and grant them your healing and your wholeness. Almighty and everlasting God, hear these our prayers, which as always we ask in the name of our Savior and our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our closing phrase today is hymn 237, Look Forward in Faith.